There's a cartoon by Russell Monroe, the XKCD artist, that shows two people speaking, and one says to the other, "That person over there believes silly things, like that fossils are fakes and the world is only 6,000 years old." And the other person goes, "Not a problem. The universe doesn't care what people believe." And the first person goes, "But that's our congressman." And the second person says, "Okay, we have a problem." I love that joke, because we do have a problem. We have congressmen who don't believe in things like fossils and evolution. But what's wrong with that? After all, they were elected. I'm going to say, what's wrong with that, and what we can do about it, if anything. First of all, let me say that this is not what I thought 21st century politics was going to be like. When I was a graduate student in the humanities in the 1970s, the late 1970s, my professors thundered against what they called the coming technocratic state. Politicians, they said, would soon not care about human values, but only about efficiency. Politicians, they said, would soon not listen to citizens, but only to scientists and engineers. If only. Never before have there been so many issues that required so much scientific input to solve. Issues involving energy, the environment, infectious diseases, pollution, global warming, and so forth. But never before has the required scientific input been so sabotaged, misused, or ignored. Scientists, politicians sometimes even view scientists as the enemy. Now, is that over the top? A few years ago, a United States Congressman, Paul Brown of Georgia, declared that evolution, embryology, and the Big Bang Theory were lies straight from the pit of hell, and said that he knew the universe was only a few thousand years old. And what do you suppose happened to him? He not only got reelected, but he was put on the House committee in charge of the United States Science and Technology Program. Now, how does science denial work? I'm fascinated by stories, and they can be real or fictional, which illustrate the dynamics of the collision between science and social, economic, or religious values. And one of my favorites is in the movie Jaws. Has anyone seen it? Small seaside town that depends for its livelihood on tourism. The day before the first major holiday of the season, a woman's badly mangled body washes up on shore. A scientist from the Oceanographic Institute, played by the nerdy Richard Dreyfuss, says, "It's a shark." The town's mayor, who was terrified at the prospect of closing the beaches, says, "We have to be reasonable. We have to act in the town's best interest. It was probably a boating accident." And by the way, that isn't Richard Dreyfuss acting in his own self-interest? Isn't he really interested in getting into the pages of National Geographic? Now, we in the audience, we watching the film, are in a special position. Unlike anyone in the film at that point, we've actually seen the shark, so we know what's up and we know whom to believe. But what about the people on film? What about the people in the town? To them, it seems like just a question of the judgment of one person, Richard Dreyfuss, versus the other, the town's mayor. Now, when science denial happens, it's really easy. Whoops, wait, I forgot to show you my picture of the shark. When science denial happens, it's really easy to try to find a villain to blame it on. The press, scientific illiteracy, maybe what sociologists call amoral calculators, or people who know what the right thing to do is, but are swayed by political, economic, or religious factors, or villains, people who know what the good is but don't do it. But really, it's a question of authority. Why is the authority of science in government so low? Someone who thought about that an awful lot was Jack Marburger, the former US presidential science advisor. And Marburger liked to tell the following story. Shortly after the 9/11 terrorist attack, you might recall, someone sent letters containing deadly anthrax spores to a number of congressmen and to some news agencies. Five people died and more were injured. And mail became piling up that might or might not contain anthrax. And Marburger was asked to come up with a method to neutralize the anthrax so that the letters could be read. And he convened a team of scientists, and they did some research, consulted the literature, came up with a recommendation involving electron beam irradiation. He turned the method over to the government, and it looked like a triumph of the use of science for the public good. But a funny thing happened. When the method was first tried, it didn't work. It burnt the mail to a crisp. And Marburger looked into it and found that the government officials had second-guessed the scientists. They had reasoned that if the scientists had said that the safe dose was, that the right dose was a certain amount, let's say X, wouldn't it be a lot safer to up the dose, make it 5X or 10X? And when he had the dose scaled back, the method worked just fine. Now, Marburger called this a relatively benign instance of a potentially disastrous behavior, namely the tendency of government officials to ignore or alter scientific advice. And he had more serious examples, such as the Bush administration's claim in 2002 that the Iraqi government was looking for certain kinds of aluminum tubes because they wanted to produce nuclear weapons, which scientists said was wrong. But after Marburger stepped down as science advisor, he began to investigate, why is science such a weak force in government circles? And he consulted the writings of Max Weber, German sociologist and historian, who is well known for his writings on the nature of authority, or the reasons why we obey commands that were issued by others. And Weber distinguished between three kinds of authority: traditional, legal, rational, and charismatic. Traditional authority is the authority of age-old practices. It's the authority of the village elders. Legal, rational authority is grounded in the belief in the legitimacy of enacted rules. It's the authority of the law. Charismatic authority is grounded in the perception that certain individuals have exceptional powers or are able to do exceptional things, things that no one else could. And Weber said charismatic authority was irrational, but it's one of the few means that politicians have to take people on new paths. I mean, think of Martin Luther King or Mahatma Gandhi or Winston Churchill. Now, which of these three is science? Not the first two. No society is traditionally scientific. And no country insists that its mandates that its laws be grounded in science. So Marburger concluded that the authority of science in government circles was charismatic. That is, politicians consider scientists authoritative to the extent that they perceive them as having special powers or able to do special things, create new kinds of bombs that couldn't be done otherwise. Now, scientists, and probably many of you, think that this is crazy. I mean, because science is not grounded in charisma, that we can rely on it? And isn't a scientific finding not someone's particular opinion, but the product of a huge infrastructure, a set of institutions that involve a collective set of procedures like analysis, data, testing, and so forth? True, but Marburger's point was that's the way it might look from the inside, but from the outside, it may look like one person's judgment against another. Richard Dreyfuss's opinion versus the town mayor. Now, I know what you're all probably thinking. You're thinking, oh no, I'm about to say that the solution for the problem of the low authority science has in government is to make scientists more charismatic, make them great performers, maybe bring in scientific star power. I mean, maybe we can get Beyoncé or Angelina Jolie to promote science. And doesn't this cheapen science? I agree with you. Fortunately, there's a fourth kind of authority that Weber doesn't mention, and that's trust. Trust is a powerful force in politics. It's much more powerful than data. And when we trust science, we're not trusting one person's viewpoint, one person's opinion, we're trusting the entire scientific infrastructure. So the long-range solution for the low authority that science has in government is to increase the trust that politicians have in the scientific infrastructure and what happens in laboratories like this one. But that's not easy, and there's some very serious problems, one of which is that the infrastructure tends to withdraw into the background. It tends to become invisible. A few years ago, a United States congressman said, "What do we need Landsat satellites for when we've got Google Earth?" It's easy to use the products of science, Google Earth, without even seeing the infrastructure, the Landsat satellites that make it possible. And it's because the infrastructure tends to withdraw that leaves a vacuum for these other forces, social, political, religious, to come in. There's other problems, too. Another one is that scientific institutions can make mistakes. And people can seize on these mistakes and exploit them in order to undermine trust in science. I call these people social iagos, after the character in the Shakespeare play Othello, who advances his career by sowing distrust. And the third problem is simply time. Trust takes time to develop. And the speed of political decision making moves much quicker than the speed of trust development. Okay, so are there any little things we can do in the meantime? And there are a few, and they involve exposing how bad decision making tends to be if it doesn't trust the scientific infrastructure. And one method is humor. Here at CERN, you may recall the Daily Show episode a few years ago about the possibility that your accelerator, the LHC, would produce a black hole that would destroy the universe. Anybody see that? The amazing thing about that episode was that even though it ostensibly took the threat seriously, a viewer came away not only reassured, but also with a pretty good idea just what was feeding the hype. Humor, yes. Humor is a great way of exposing the magical thinking involved in shark denial. A second method is to get nasty and aggressive. The next time a politician says that they don't believe in evolution, let's demand that that politician take a pledge saying that they will refuse and will insist that their constituents refuse any medical treatment whose development was based on evolutionary biology. The president of my university, whose specialty is infectious diseases, likes to say that microbes and viruses are evolution in motion. In light of the Ebola plague, isn't any legislator who doesn't believe in evolution and therefore in the value of doing research into it an urgent public health threat? Making these pledges, and you can concoct different kinds of pledges for different kinds of science denial, making these kind of pledges is a way of saying, science walks the walk, do you? Just how strong are your other commitments? And a final thing that we can do is tell parables. Parables are short stories, they're very accessible, and with a built-in meaning. And parables tend to circulate and become part of the cultural common sense. Let's multiply the parables we have about how bad decision making is if it doesn't trust the scientific infrastructure. The relatively benign parables like the Postal Service story, or very serious ones like the aluminum tubes equals desire to produce nuclear weapons parable. Let's point to episodes like those in Jaws. Let's write and stage more plays like those of Ibsen's play Enemy of the People, which is kind of the granddaddy of the genre. And what these parables do is to point out how silly it is to try to make the shark go away by magical thinking. Now, if we do all of these things all the time, we might not change the mind of the politician in the XKCD cartoon, but I think we will begin to change the climate in which they get elected. And our challenge in the long run is to find ways to make more visible the scientific infrastructure, what happens in laboratories like this one, that make very explicit the source of its authority, and therefore why it can be trusted. Thank you.